Okay, my friends, another deep dive. This is Don Lincoln, Fermi Lab. Don and I are not that far apart. We're not that different. He's looking for the focus is on the big unanswered questions of science. And he's looking for muons and all that kind of stuff, which we found. Let me show you his articles. But I really am now focusing on the eternity of life. You know, now that I found the physical elements, which he's looking for, I found them, Don, and I can help you with this if we could converse. Okay, Don Lincoln's looking for the big answers. Well, we have some answers. He's asking about these two particles, the fixed particle and the point particle. This is 9 years ago, and they react exactly as the particles we found, and they are identical to the five particles we found. Okay, this is Don Lincoln, and these are the smallest particles they've ever been able to find, which is this black fixed particle and this white point particle. They're actually neutrinos. They attach together and turn into what they call a gluon. And we have created these particles and separated them from photons, not protons. So we really know what's going on, not just digging through debris. Okay, there's the particles. This is the Fermi Lab article from Don Lincoln, and these are the particles he's looking for. We realize that they come from light. They're trying to find them in protons. Protons are not one big gigantic ball. They are 1,835 of these particles together. Every black has a white attached to it, and every white has a black attached to it in their normal configuration. We actually accelerated the light. We started with light, so this is light. And we ended up with the particles that Don Lincoln's looking for. We accelerated it through a venturi and actually separated the black from the white. The black and the white are totally separated here. And I believe we can get free energy if I can get somebody at Fermi Lab to speak with me. I'm blocked from there. I can't comment. I can't discuss. I've been told to stay away. Okay, so Don Lincoln is looking for the big answers. Well, this is it right here. This is dark matter. And that's a black hole. And this is created in outer space in a vacuum chamber. Had nothing in it whatsoever. No particles in it whatsoever. In zero gravity. That's the key. You can't do this on Earth. They injected plasma in here, which is an ionized micron-sized dust. Ionized means it has charge, the charged particles. Charged means they have a glow to them. When you have a charge, you have a glow. It's charged up. It's ready to go. Well, it also has a black matter attached. We never realized the black matter was attached. And in outer space, it can push it all into a ball in the center and create the black hole surrounded by the white particles, which he calls the point particles. This is where the fixed particles collect all together because they are gravity. Right, which leads to a whole nother question about what is really in the internal part of our Earth. Is it an iron core? I don't think so. I think it's got a lot of dark matter, whether the dark matter is fixed to other particles or whether it is actually literally a hole. But I can tell you what, it sucks particles that are ionized particles down to it, just like this would be the Earth. It's pulling all the particles. You throw something up, it comes right back down. Zip, boom. You throw it this way, boom. It comes back. Throw it that way, it comes back. Doesn't matter. That's gravity. This, and you know, the funny thing is, this was the first interaction I had with Don Lincoln. I sent him this as I was corresponding to the Russians about this black hole, and I asked him to see. I think we could separate the white from the black, which was the same particles he was showing, the fixed and the point. And from then it went all downhill. And I tried to explain to him, because I already had all of my experiments were all done at this time. We had the light was shown to divide, as I showed you. The black and the white particles, they divide. At this point, all of this was done. This was 2015. And from there on, and I've never been able to correspond, but I'm on block from Fermi Lab now, from posting or commenting. So, you know, with the evidence I have, I don't think that's correct to say you can't speak. You know, especially when it's a government agency. They're spending a lot of my money. Okay, so I you probably already have seen or will see that I have information on black holes and what are black holes. This is Fermilab. I just tried to say, all I did was put down, hi Don, because I knew they wouldn't allow me to speak. So comment failed to post. And they won't allow me to post up there because what I say is undeniable, and they want to deny it so they can continue on smashing protons when we did it with light. That's what they really want to do, is it with light. So, once again, Fermilab, we found those particles. They react exactly as Don Lincoln says. The black one is an extended particle, and it has a fixed size. And it may have a fuzzy edge around it, which it does. The point-like particles are mathematical abstractions with zero size. Even zero-size particles have an extended effect due to the effect of the field surrounding them. It appears to be strictly a field. I have to agree with both of those statements. And we did find both of these particles. Now, the real thing is, though, what is the big unanswered questions of science? I think I've answered the questions of what dark matter is and dark energy and light, and there's a new atomic model. It's called the dipole electron flood theory. So these all have to be discussed. The standard model doesn't work. They know it doesn't work. Gravity doesn't work. Dark matter doesn't work. Nothing works. And we know that space is basically filled with particles. Even Don Lincoln says, look it up, quantum foam. He calls it quantum foam, and it is. It's the light particles that are in space, the particles I just showed you, those little black and red and white ones. They're all over the space because that's all light is those particles. They are particles. So, Don, the big unanswered questions of science is, let there be light. Who said it? Who said, let there be light? Where did the light come from, Don? Let's see what I say is the big questions in science. Okay, so I say this is the big unanswered questions, is what is this gigantic fish here in the desert doing laying here in the desert? That's a gigantic fish. And he was being attacked by a gigantic dragon who spit dragon venom all over his back, his fin. Now, this is the gigantic dragon's head, and that is his red, flaming, flared eye, and this is all the stuff that he spit down at that fish, and it is extremely toxic and very, very aggressive to the tissue of the fish, because it ate right through, right down to his blood vessels, as I will show you right now. This is the back of the fish. You see that fish, how perfect he is? This head, the head part is a little obscured. That's not his eye, I don't think. I think that's his eye right there. And these are the scales. And the tail comes and swishes around here. And this is his fin up at the top. And the dragon spit this down. Look at the tissue there. These are the big unanswered questions, Don. How did this happen? Who was responsible for that? That is biology, my friends. These are arteries, and they squirt into these little tiny blood vessels here, which oxygenate that fish's body when it was alive. This is biology. This is not just runoff in the desert. This is deteriorated flesh all the way down to the blood vessels. Now, the dragon's head is here, way on one side of Africa, and the other side of him is on the other side of Africa. It goes all the way down his throat. This is his throat. Follow it down. All right, there's his throat going down. All this stuff here is bleed off and runoff of a dead, decaying body. That's what they call effluent. And that's the gases and the fluids. This thing has not been there that long. Now, in the ancient text, it talks about this exact event, and it talks about Zeus cutting Typhon's throat with his great and mighty sword, and blood creates the greenest green there is. You can buy blood meal to make your plants grow greener than green, and that's what it is right there, in the desert, greener than green. Now, the throat runs all the way down into the guts, and he has the legs of a human, the thighs of a human, exactly what was stated by Apollodorus in 150 BC. His tail runs all the way out here. This is the dragon scales tail right here. You see? The same thing is running off the bodily fluids. These are dragon plates. You see the different colors? Those are different colored metal plates on this dragon's body. This is not just accidental armor. I don't know what to say. It's a gigantic dragon runs across. That's the big unanswered questions, Don. The big unanswered questions. I've answered the questions of dark matter and all that stuff. That's actually kind of simple. Very simple. Once you go into electron flow theory and you understand that a proton is actually 1839 of these black and white particles. Nobody's ever seen a dark matter before. That's the dark matter. They say, where's all the dark matter? It's attached to the light matter. They're attached. They're a single unit. But the dark matter doesn't emit. It doesn't absorb. It doesn't reflect. The only thing it does is it attract. So we never saw it before. The only reason we saw it now is because of the experiments Rod and I did with the Venturi, so that we know we started with light. They started with a whole batch of big, huge, huge things, smashed them head on, and then they just have debris. That's what Don Lincoln's doing. We squirted through light, photons of light, and created our electron neutrinos and muon neutrinos, and then we divided them into their what they call a sterile muon, all by itself, the black particle. And that happens in space, in a vacuum. They will go right by themselves. Very strange. And this was one of the first interactions I had with Don Lincoln, as I sent him the Russians' black hole experiment, as I was corresponding to the Russians about it. And I said, take a look at this. This is where the dark matter is the stuff that you're showing is your fixed particle. Let me show you. Now, I'm sure most academics' mind is already shut off. This is way too much for them to absorb. These are dragon plates that coat his neck. That's his throat coming down. This is that fluty, flashy-looking stuff that they have on the side of dragons in the parades. You see it running down here? Every time you see a parade, they have this little flashy-looking fluty stuff running down the side of the dragon. Now, this dragon runs all the way across North Africa from one side to the other. His legs are the thighs of a human. Let's talk about that. These are the unanswered questions, Don. All right, let's talk about the unanswered questions. Let's take a deep dive into the past and the meaning, if there is any meaning to it. Maybe those giants and dragons all was just no meaning, but I think there was. What were you taught about where we came from in our history? Did you ever consider there was gigantic dragons and giants miles tall? What about the battles that were in the heavens? What about Typhon and Zeus? What about the rebellious gods that came to Earth and ruined everything? What about the eternal gods and the Sky Brothers? All of that stuff indigenous people talk about. I always considered it insanity myself, absolutely, until I discovered mud fossils. And I did discover them 10 years ago, a little more. And they are creatures frozen in stone, just like that gigantic dragon I just showed you in Africa. And I have, this is a goose. This is a feather pattern in the goose's head. See the feathers? I discovered these mud fossils and how they formed. And they formed in a hot salt water flood. And every side of them is flat on one side and perfect on the other. And it's because they died and were killed and actually boiled in the oceans, in the water, not really oceans probably, but in rivers and lakes. For 7 days, a comet burning with the intensity of the sun approached the Earth. and scorch the earth. And literally, they say in the ancient texts, it boiled the rivers and lakes from the intensity of the heat coming at us. And then once it hit our atmosphere, it compressed all the H's and O's, the hydrogens and oxygens, and turned them into H2O's, which is water. That's where all the floodwaters, well, not all of them, but a lot of them came from there. And they came down as hot, raining hot water, boiling hot water, and just wiped out everything on Earth, basically. The only ones that lived were the ones that were deep in caves, way up in the mountains, it appears. That's the only ones, I think, that made it through this, because a lot of them did. They say there's only 7 people left if you follow all the ancient texts in the Bible and so forth, Noah's flood. Well, this was Noah's flood, yes. I don't disagree with that, because everything I have is flat on one side and flawless on the other. And my stuff is DNA tested and CAT scan. It's all done. So these are the unanswered questions. How did all this stuff happen? Where did these giant creatures come from? What about Typhon, the giant dragon I just showed you? Here's what they wrote about him in 150 BC. This is more mind-blowing, is that they are said to be immortal, these things. What does that mean to us? If they're immortal, they're around somewhere. The stories written appear crazy until you look at the fish and the dragon in Morocco and then read what the earliest texts say about them. All right? Now, I have a video up here about it. Actually, this links to the Apollodorus texts. But this is about Typhon. When the gods had overcome the giants, and the giants I have, mine are DNA certified, Earth, still more enraged, had intercourse with Tartarus and brought forth Typhon. He's that dragon. Well, what is Typhon? He's a hybrid between a man and a beast. Size and strength surpassed all offspring of Earth. This is about his thighs. Why would they point out his thighs? As far as the thighs, he was of human shape and of such prodigious bulk that he outtopped all the mountains. His head often brushed the stars. One of his hands reached out to the west, the other to the east, covered a whole entire continent. All right, now, and this is as far as I could see, this is it. Here's his thighs. They point out exactly his thighs, and all of this red stuff, which looks like just mud and clay and stuff, that's not. That's his scorpion, or I don't know whatever they call them. They look like octopus legs, and they come around, they wrap all the way around. And if you look at this real closely, you can tell this is leather. All right, this is not just sand dunes. All right, go take these pictures to somebody that does tanning. That's leather. All right, and that's his hide coming around. I mean, the damn thing covers all of North Africa, whole top of North Africa. Standing up, this would be twice or more higher than the space station. All right, space base would be down here somewhere. Typhon gonna be somewhere up in here. Oh man, what a world! All right, I'm gonna probably wrap it up pretty soon here. We're talking about Typhon. Typhon was here. That's all. That's all I can say. Gaia and Tartarus created Typhon. Everything came from chaos. So this is the root of the earth, of the, you know, the mountains, of the planets, of everything. And Typhon was actually, there's no question in my mind, that's 100% certain. Typhon is exactly what they said he was, and he is in the desert, and his throat was cut by Zeus. Okay, this is how they showed and portrayed Typhon, which we know he's not like that as a human head. His thighs were the human thighs. That's the one thing they pointed out. And they said he was a half man, half beast. Now, he was all... Anyway, you saw him in the desert. And these are the coils. And Zeus killed him. This is all recorded in the mists. And, you know, I've had people attack me for saying, oh, you can't mix these two together, science and what they would call religion. I'm saying I'm a material scientist. This creature right here, in a little bit of a different form, but with the coils and the human thighs, appears to have been killed by what they call Zeus. And he's laying in the desert. That's all I can tell you. And it's exactly what Apollodorus wrote, identical. And he was one of the first creatures that was created from Gaia, who was Mother Earth. It's beyond belief, and I can't interpret it in a meaningful way. I'm trying. But it appears that there's some very, very bad entities in this universe, and there's some very, very good entities. And you spend your time in eternity, I think, with one or the other. That's what they've written. I have right now no reason to disbelieve the things that were written about do this, do that, don't do this, don't do that. These guys existed. Everything I'm finding was true. The flood happened, and not that long ago. It's very, very recent. It's a very young Earth, nothing like what they're talking about. And if we are biology, which we are, at 100% of the Earth is biology, every cell in your body has a programmed time limit that it lives. And then it's so-called apoptosis. It says, all right, I've lived my life, I'm going, done. That's basically prophecy. They say the Earth is going to last 6,000 years, whatever they said. And if we are a biological entity, Earth, Gaia, it's got a lifespan, just like us as humans. So, well, I'll throw some humans down there, but I'm only going to give them 120 years. So there is a biological clock to all life. Bacteria only live so long. We only live so long. Cats and dogs only live so long. It's just built into the creature. And as far as I'm concerned right now, Earth is a creature. 2015, I did a video saying Earth is alive and in deep trouble. And it is. And I still believe it's alive, only I think it's probably dead now after fracking and all the things we've done to it. And the rivers are running dry and everything. That's the lifeblood of the Earth. All those things that we took for granted. I think and maybe the Earth knew we were going to do this. Somehow maybe it was programmed to do this. And then we're going to burn up. Because I think that's going to be the end. But that's what I'm finding. As you read the ancient texts, it says it will be a time of travail. And I'm seeing it coming right about this time, right now, it looks like to me. So, steel yourself for eternity, my friends. Okay, my friends, well, let's just continue on with this. Academia.edu, I put up some papers on there. I have quite a few of them up there, actually. And Living Universe and the God Concept was my top paper last week. From they do statistics on who's paying attention and how many hits you're getting and all that. So apparently there's some interest in that. So let's talk about the God concept and about the living universe. And I'm going to tell you right now, I have been getting as deep as you can possibly get into that. And I think, let's talk about it. It's deep. You see this? This goes back to 2015 from another channel that I started. It was totally destroyed by academia and flat earthers. Absolutely turned into absolute chaos. So I abandoned it and started a new station. But listen to this. I'm talking about, this is a brief comparison between the Russian and Florida sinkholes of death to living blue holes. This planet is it. And we better start taking care of our home. I start out by showing all about blue holes and, sinkholes and all this. Now, here, listen to this part.
A digestive system. Now, these are what's happening.
I'm claiming that these are the digestive systems, these blue holes and these sinkholes. They take in debris, and they do just like we do. They poop it out into the ocean. And I show it actually happening, the poop coming out into the ocean. All right, now, listen to this, though.
But in Florida and Russia, these are those blue holes dying. Now, these were underneath the tundra, and they weren't seen, but they still are the digesters. Now, as the tundra recedes, it's just caving in because the digesters are dying. Methane gas is coming up in the decomposition of the earth, of the life of the earth, is what I'm saying. Now, this may not be, you know, don't panic. I mean, nobody's going to even pay attention probably, but certainly you wouldn't panic about this because we don't know. We don't know what's going on there. But there's the ones in Florida are virtually identical.
Well, they're all identical. They're digesters for the earth. And right now, if you look at what happens in a sinkhole, here's the way they work. You see this? These sinkholes go in here, and they work all the way through, and then they get actually literally pooped out as the tide goes out. These are the decomposition areas, and here he is right here. He's down in the poop, and he's putting his arm deep in the poop. Listen.
This is a layer of decomposing leaves and other organic stuff. The decomposition creates hydrogen sulfide, a deadly gas that smells like rotting eggs.
Yeah, it's just like farts. It's rotting that material and putting it back into the biostream.
The water is saturated with hydrogen sulfide, and I can smell it in the water that seeps around the edge of my mask.
We all know that smell.
Farts. All right, and it goes out at the tide. When the tide actually goes out, mucus forms. Well, look at this. This is what the poop is going out in this lower layer. Watch.
With its silt and hydrogen sulfide from the inland blue holes.
Poop.
It forms clouds near the bottom with a distinct line between the clear ocean water above and the silty hydrogen sulfide layer below.
Check out the mucus
from
mucous membrane.
What you're seeing here are the decomposing remains of forest vegetation which have passed entirely through the caves and out into the ocean.
Sounds like digestive system to me.
Everywhere I find what look like strands of mucus floating in.
Look at the strands of mucus to cover up the coral to protect it. This is exactly identical to what happens in us. And then the mucus goes away at the end.
Hydrogen sulfide. As the tide carries the toxic water away, the corals will go back to normal.
I did like 9 videos on all of the problems we're having on Earth. And you know the only people that I ever heard from? I heard from the Russians. They want to know about their sinkholes. Nothing from NASA or anybody. I was showing the Mars crab. I was showing all the sinkholes all over the Earth. But the ones in Russia, and then they have problems. They have real serious problems. Well, we all do. But the more you take out of the ground, there used to be a level in here that kept the tundra floating on top of it. That's gone. These things are just collapsing. When they do, all of the stuff that used to digest and turn the methanes into, somehow they would get into the system of the earth, I don't know how, in the lower layers of the aquifer, or whatever you want to call it. But now, they're being digested back out in methane. Some of these things are on fire, and they'll never go out. Okay, so as far as Don Lincoln goes, he's looking for the big unanswered questions of science. I say science is not just physics or chemistry or geology or biology. It's all of those things, and that's what I address. And I'd love to speak with Don. He seems to have a very fertile mind, and I would love to discuss with him. But you have to be open, and you have to be able to discuss, you know, and not just profess. And that's what I heard from Don, and I'd rather discuss. I'd rather have questioning. He never asked me one question other than to, you know, go read chapter 26 or, you know, you, you, you know, actually, he did sort of call me a couple of names, which that's okay. I don't care. You know, to everybody else, that's what I look like, kind of a tinfoil hat guy. But I am not. I am a material scientist, and until you can engage with the material science I present, then, you know, you're never going to answer any questions. There is no questions. You don't have questions.